Welcome back to our coverage of Amazon's Invincible, based off the Robert Kirkman series of the same name. Now, this is going to be our last episode in our first season coverage for the show. In order for this video to make the most sense, feel free to go back and check out our other complete history videos for characters in Invincible. There should be a card on the screen now for that playlist. Today's episode is on one of the most powerful beings and coolest dudes in the entire Invincible universe, Alan the Alien. Or just Alan. Now, before we begin, keep in mind this video is not going to cover every single issue, conversation, or action that Alan has, but it will cover the vast majority of the most important elements of his story. However, before we begin, we want to thank the sponsor of today's video, Keeps. 2/3 of men will experience some form of male pattern baldness before they're 35, and I know my hairline is running away from my face faster than Omni-Man ran away from the planet. Keeps is a subscription service that partners men with doctors to help treat male pattern baldness. Now look, not all of us were blessed with the luscious locks of love that somebody like Mark Grayson has, but that doesn't mean you need to end up looking like Cecil Stedman out here. With Keeps, a real licensed doctor will review your specific hair loss scenario online and recommend the right treatment plan for you. Then your treatment is shipped directly to your door every 3 months. With hair loss, prevention is the key, and Keeps can take 4 to 6 months to start seeing results, so it's time to act now. If you're ready to take action and prevent hair loss, go to keeps.com/keyissues or click the link in the description to receive 50% off your first order. That's keeps.com/keyissues. Thanks again, and let's learn about Alan. Alan's first full comic book appearance was in Invincible number 5. Now, some people might argue that his first appearance is in Invincible number 2. It's not. Half of his face is in one panel, and that is called a cameo, people. Don't let anybody tell you otherwise. The first time we meet Alan the Alien is when Omni-Man calls on his son Mark and asks him to investigate an enemy coming into Earth's atmosphere. Nolan tells Mark that he's on an important mission with the Guardians of the Globe and asks Mark to fight this intruder in his place. Nolan says that he's fought this guy before and he isn't too tough, but he would be the strongest guy that Mark has faced yet. Mark flies into space, and it's there that Mark enters into combat with an alien cyclops named Alan. Alan and Mark battle, with the two warriors communicating via Alan's native telepathy. And after a brief battle, Alan stops the fight and informs Mark that he's come to Earth as an employee and scout of the Coalition of Worlds. Alan's job is a champion evaluation officer, or in layman's terms, Alan goes to planets and checks out if they have someone there powerful enough to stop minor orbital threats. His job is to go from planet to planet fighting each planet's champion to make sure that they're up to the Coalition standards, something he gets to do once every 3 years per planet. It's quickly determined, however, that Alan has, unbeknownst to himself, misread his assignment and he's been going to the wrong planet for quite a long time. Alan has been showing up to the planet Earth, but he was supposed to be showing up to the planet Urath. Obviously, this is pretty embarrassing for Alan, so he thanks Mark for clearing everything up and he bolts back to his home, the Coalition of Worlds' home planet of Telescria. However, it's time for a brief detour. Here we learn Alan's backstory and origin. Alan is a member of the Unopan species of aliens. He was born in a breeding camp after his home planet was invaded and conquered by Viltrumites. Alan was essentially a manufactured being, born as part of a selective breeding program, which was a collaboration between the leader of the Unopans and a leader of the Coalition of Worlds, a man named Thetis. Thetis is someone I haven't discussed much in previous videos, but he is very important for the overall narrative and Alan's story, so I will touch on him briefly here. Alan was the only successful candidate from the program, with the rest having significant physical and mental defects. He grew to be the most powerful and skilled Unopan fighter ever, capable of beating any being he was put up against. However, even as the strongest member of the Coalition of Worlds, he was still no match for the average Viltrumite. Because it was believed that Unopans didn't possess the genetic ability to become as strong as Viltrumites, the program was shut down and Alan was made a champion evaluation officer by Thetis. However, even unbeknownst to Alan, his true purpose was to find beings stronger than himself and report them back to the Coalition of Worlds. From there, these beings would be recruited to stand against the Viltrumites. But Alan was stronger than all of the beings he ever encountered, except for Nolan Grayson, who was already a Viltrumite unbeknownst to Alan. After all, Alan was going to the wrong planet, and he didn't know that Nolan was a Viltrumite. Alright, now we're back in the main timeline, and remember the mission that Omni-Man said he was on with the Guardians of the Globe? Well, that was him murdering them all. Subsequently, the events played out that led to Mark and Nolan fighting and Nolan leaving the planet. Alan eventually returns to Earth to inform Mark that he needs to be careful because there's a Viltrumite living on your planet, but Mark's obviously already well aware of that, having learned the history of his father's purpose on Earth, as well as his own lineage and purpose. Mark offers Alan his assistance in the future if there's any way that he can prevent more damage to Earth and help stop the Viltrumites. Alan asks Mark for his next move, and Mark jokes that he's gonna finish high school. Alan returns home to Telescria and he meets with his girlfriend Telia, who is a confirmed space baddie. The two embrace, not having seen each other in a long time, and Telia tries to get down to brass tacks, aka alien sex. However, in a conversation that reoccurs time and time again throughout the series, Alan is very conflicted about actually knocking space boots. Unupans are forbidden to physically reproduce outside of their breeding factories due to their near extinction. However, the argument doesn't last long, as Alan always gives in and has sex with her anyway. Alan and Telia go to dinner, and we learn of Alan's most favorite food and another recurring joke throughout the series, Conslock. However, their dinner is cut short when a Viltrumite flies in and blasts Alan into outer space. Now in outer space, Alan is questioned by the Viltrumite General Craig, his right-hand man Lucan, and I don't actually know this guy's name. Maybe it's Barry. He looks like a Barry. Let's call him Barry. Craig asks him about the Viltrumites on Earth, and when Alan gives him a smart-ass answer, the three Viltrumites beat him to death and leave him in space. And this ends the life of Alan the Alien. Thank you for watching this video. No, I'm kidding. Everybody in this series gets the crap kicked out of them and ripped in half, and they all survive it. It's so weird. Alan's body is quickly recovered by the Coalition of Worlds, but he's left in a coma for months. A dozen or so issues later, in issue 38, Alan wakes up from his coma and busts out of his healing bed, except now he is jacked to the max. He's still not quite as big as me, but hey, he has made some gains. Alan is informed that after they ran tests on him, his strength and invulnerability is near Viltrumite levels, and with training he could even surpass them. And Alan is fairly confused, as it's believed that the Coalition doesn't have much data on the Viltrumite's upper strength levels. Thetis reveals to Alan that, surprise, he was a Viltrumite all along, and the first to abandon the Viltrumite Empire, and possibly the only one to abandon the Viltrumite Empire until he heard of Mark and Nolan Grayson. Alan returns to Earth where he encounters the Immortal, who had kinda gone off the deep end a bit following the death of his wife, Duplicate, and to learn more about that, check out his video. The two battle for a couple minutes before Mark arrives and lets the Immortal know that he is a joke compared to thick boy Unupan Alan. Mark tells Immortal that Alan is a friend and leads Alan away, back to his dorm room at college where the two discuss all that occurred. Mark tells him that his father betrayed the Viltrumite Empire and went to another planet, had another son, and was beaten up by the Viltrumites and taken captive, and that Mark brought his brother back to Earth to raise him. Again, if you want to learn about this, watch Nolan and Mark's videos. Alan tries to recruit Mark into the Coalition of Worlds, but Mark declines because space sucks. Mark jokingly asks if they have to fight now, but Alan declines, saying that he's too valuable to the Coalition and that Mark couldn't beat Alan in a fight anyway, so there's really no point. Despite not leaving with Alan, Mark lets Alan scan the information in novels that Nolan wrote while he was living on Earth. While living on Earth, Nolan was an author who wrote various science fiction books. In reality, the fictional stories told very real myths about weapons and beings that could harm Viltrumites throughout the galaxy. Alan leaves Earth to report back to the Coalition of Worlds on these findings. However, along the way back to the Coalition of Worlds, he is intercepted by a Viltrumite warship. He battles Anessa, who is a very powerful and predatory Viltrumite, and allows himself to be beaten and captured. The Viltrumites are very curious about Alan's strength levels, so they place him in captivity instead of just killing him. However, unbeknownst to them, Alan has secretly allowed himself to be captured so that he could see if Nolan was on board the ship in captivity. Alan and Nolan meet in captivity, and Nolan and Alan frequently talk via Alan's telepathy. Over a period of a few months, the two become best friends. Alan often speaks of his love for his girlfriend, and in so doing helps Nolan realize that he misses and still loves his wife, Deb, very, very much. Eventually, after Nolan has completely recovered from the injuries he sustained fighting the Viltrumites earlier in the series, they decide that it's time for him to be executed. When Alan learns that Nolan is scheduled to be executed, he breaks out of his confines and starts smashing up the ship. In the process of creating a distraction, he releases another Viltrumite prisoner and the baddest motherfucker in the universe, Battle Beast. Alan and Battle Beast free Nolan, and the three of them kick the shit out of the Viltrumites on board, who are forced to retreat. It's at this point that Nolan reveals to Alan that there are less than 50 pureblood Viltrumites in existence. Nolan reveals to Alan that a virus called the Scourge virus wreaked havoc on the Viltrumite population and killed 99.9% of them. Nolan and Alan decide to travel to Telescria to inform Thetis of the news, but Thetis is very concerned because he's found out that there is a spy working for the Viltrumites in their midst. Thetis instead decides to send Alan and Nolan out on a mission to recover some of the artifacts and resources that Nolan described in his books. These artifacts could potentially harm Viltrumites, and I'm kinda gonna space race through this part. The first artifact the team goes to find is the fabled gun of the Space Racer, one of the strongest weapons in the known universe, capable of destroying pretty much anything it shoots with a blast that essentially never stops. Nolan had left himself a map to find the gun hidden in coordinates in his books. They traveled to an asteroid which Nolan had planned to come back to when Space Racer had died of old age, but when they find it, they also find Space Racer. They all fight, they calm down, Space Racer joins the team, next item. They next attempt to retrieve these red boys called Ragnars. They are incredibly powerful and vicious creatures, and they're also frozen in hibernation. Nolan tries to grab one while it's frozen, and it gets kinda messed up and they accidentally get a few thawed out, and Alan and Nolan have to bail out of fear of being killed by the creatures. They hunt down and harvest a poisonous plant called the Klaxis plant that would significantly weaken but not kill Viltrumites, and they also attempt to rally other aliens to their side, including Battle Beast, the Glendarians, and the hero Tech Jacket. They even go looking for space sharks, which sound awesome, but we never actually get to see them, so I have inserted a drawing of what I believe a space shark would look like. You're welcome. The duo returns to Telescria, and Thetis informs Nolan of a new, more powerful version of the Scourge virus that he has developed if they can't actually end up defeating the remaining Viltrumites. The two go on their final recruitment operation to find Mark and Oliver, Nolan's sons on Earth. With everything now prepared, Nolan, Alan, Tech Jacket, Mark, and Oliver all head to Telescria, but along the way, they are ambushed by the Viltrumites' Conquest, Lucan, and another unnamed Viltrumite. Let's call this one Dirk. I don't know, it seems like a Dirk. The Viltrumites destroy their ship, and Alan blacks out in the process. When he wakes up, he fights Dirk and easily outmatches the Viltrumites. The team is overpowering the Viltrumites before a warship arrives and evens the odds. During the chaos, Oliver runs out of air and is forced to a nearby planet to breathe. In Conquest, Mark and Nolan follow him. Tech Jack and Alan stow away on the Viltrumite ship, unbeknownst to the Viltrumites. I cover the battle between Mark and Conquest in much greater detail in his video, so check that out to learn more about that part of the story. Alan and Tech Jacket are retrieved by the Coalition, and they continue their missions attacking Viltrumite strongholds. Most of these missions are successful as long as, you know, Viltrumites don't actually show up. The Coalition doesn't have the heavy guns to take down multiple Viltrumites, and Thetis needs Nolan, Mark, and Oliver back in the fight. Alan and Tech Jacket are out on a mission and are forced to return when the Viltrumites, led by Grand Regent Thrag, their leader, attacked Telescria. Alan and Tech Jacket arrive just in time to save Thetis from being killed by General Craig. They engage in a brutal battle with the Viltrumites until Mark, Nolan, and Oliver arrive to essentially save the day. Mark, Nolan, Oliver, Alan, and Tech Jacket are able to repel the Viltrumite invasion, and Thrag retreats to the Viltrumite homeworld. Thedas declares that they have won the Viltrumite War, with over 80% of the Viltrumite-controlled planets being abandoned or liberated. Thedas arranges a final attack against the Viltrum homeworld and brings the heaviest hitters he can. The group is engaged by the remaining Viltrumite forces, and they fight an absolutely brutal battle. In a last-ditch effort to defeat the overwhelming power of the Viltrumites, Thedas has Space Racer fire his gun at the core of the planet, and Thedas, Alan, Nolan, Mark, and Tech Jacket blast through the core of the planet, destroying it. After the dust from the planetary explosion has cleared, Thrag rips Thedas' head off, killing him in retaliation. Alan gets absolutely pummeled by Viltrumites until he's saved by Space Racer and they retreat, believing their best chance at victory is to regroup. To learn more about the end of the battle, check out Nolan and Mark's videos. But to make a long story short, Thrag beats the shit out of Mark and Nolan and leaves them in space heading for Earth. When Mark wakes up, he learns that Alan has been bumped up to the new leader of the Coalition and determines that Thrag is headed to Earth and rushes off as fast as he can to face him. Alan learns in a coded message left for him about the new strain of the Scourge virus that Thedas was working on. Eventually, a little bit later in the series, Nolan and Deb come to live on Telescria. During this time, Alan informs Nolan that he's planning on using the new Scourge virus on Earth to kill off the remaining Viltrumites, who are now living there as part of an arrangement with Nolan and Mark to end the Viltrumite War once and for all. This enrages Nolan, who believes that if the Viltrumites are left on Earth, in time they could grow to become like him and less hostile. The two battle and Alan overpowers and imprisons Nolan. Oliver shockingly agrees with Alan, and the two head to Earth where they confront Mark, who unsurprisingly attacks them in order to stop the virus from being unleashed. Thrag arrives and confronts the group, and in the process, it seems that Thrag's threatening presence is enough to make everybody kinda chill and back down. Thrag proposes a truce, seeing as Alan has no guarantee that all the Viltrumites are even on Earth, and that Thrag would kill all of them if something happened anyway. Alan agrees and they call a truce, kinda, because the Guardians of the Globe arrive and all hell breaks loose, and in the scrambling chaos, Oliver snaps and attempts to release the virus on Earth. However, the only person that gets infected with the virus is Mark, who Thrag retrieves and takes for study above a Viltrumite warship. Mark survives due to the fact that he's only half Viltrumite, and he briefly loses his powers, but they do eventually come back. Alan feels tremendous guilt for causing Mark to almost die and sees the error of his ways. Alan continues to lead the Coalition of Worlds until the events unfold on Earth that force Mark and Eve to leave the planet and live on Telescria. Alan helps support them and gives Mark a job as a spy, and this spy job leads to Mark finding an alien entity that sends him back in time, where he's offered the ability to right the overwhelming damage he's caused in his life. Eventually, Mark decides to return to the present, and when he returns, Alan and the Coalition learn that Thrag has formed an army of half-breed children. Thrag's children are the same species that Oliver is, part Viltrumite and part Thraxan, and they are slowly but surely retaking massive amounts of planets that they lost during the Viltrumite War. A rogue leader in the Coalition of Worlds leads Alan into a trap, where they attempt to assassinate Alan for not allowing them to do the exact same thing and breed the Viltrumites to make their own half-breed army. Alan easily overpowers them, but is blown up when the leader Elia triggers a suicide bomb. Obviously, Alan needs a little bit of time to recover, but this time he recovers in a few days instead of weeks or months. Alan is next seen at the funeral of Mark's brother, Oliver Grayson, who died during a surprise attack by Thrag on Mark, Oliver, and Eve while they were on vacation. Alan had Oliver working as a double agent for Thrag. Thrag believed that Oliver was working to help re-establish the Viltrum Empire, but he was secretly feeding info back to Alan on Thrag's plans. Thrag ends up killing him nonetheless, and Mark blames Alan for his death. Alan later admits to his girlfriend that he knew everything would transpire the way that it did, and he allowed it to happen anyway. Kind of a dick move, but Alan does confess and tell Mark, who reluctantly forgives him. Alan needs Mark for the upcoming battle against Thrag, and Mark needs Alan. The strongest members of the cosmic portion of the Invincible Universe unite to attack Thrag on the homeworld of Battle Beast, where he's taken up refuge and established a command center. This sets up a final battle, where Mark is able to lead Thrag towards Earth. A massive battle occurs outside of Earth in space, and in the process, Nolan is killed by Thrag. Alan is absolutely crushed by the death of Nolan, and his sorrow leads the general of Thrag's half-breed army and daughter of Thrag, Ursa, to finally stop the fighting. She surrenders and leaves Mark to fight Thrag one-on-one. Mark fights Thrag in a brutal battle on the surface of the sun, ultimately killing him. Alan arrives at the last second and rescues Mark from dying on the surface of the star, and after he recovers, Mark becomes the new leader of the Viltrumite Empire. Alan frees Thrag's children and forgives them, knowing that they were manipulated by their father into being foot soldiers in his war against the Coalition. Toward the end of the series, after Mark has beaten his final major threat, Robot, and taken up the mantle of leader of the remaining Viltrumites, Mark and Alan part ways. Mark spends decades trying his best to bring peace to the galaxy and help war-torn worlds. Eventually, a much older version of Alan and Mark meet once more, with Alan concerned that Mark is doing such a good job protecting and cleaning up the galaxy that they don't really need the Coalition anymore. Alan and Mark fight one last time, with Mark overpowering him and Alan surrendering. The minor conflict ends, and Alan asks Mark one last time, "You're really going to change everything, aren't you?" It is implied that the Coalition of Worlds disbands, no longer needed thanks to Mark and the Viltrumites. Despite the fact that there's no longer a Coalition of Worlds, I like to think that Alan looked at Mark proud of the man that he had become. Alan never passes away in the series, so it's presumed that he lives for quite a long time. And that is about it for the history of Alan the Alien. I hope you guys learned a lot, and this is the last episode for the first season, but we will be back when season 2 debuts, breaking down all the new characters that you guys get to learn about. Thank you guys for checking out this video. This has been Nick with Key Issues, and remember the motto, Alan over everything.